Am I on? Is this working? Oh, brilliant. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Welcome to AEC on this Sunday morning. I still apologize for the hair, if you were here a couple of weeks ago when I was up front. I couldn't cut it for a play. The play's now finished, but there are no hairdressers open at 12:30 on a Sunday morning, which is when I got home. So you'll have to wait until I can get it cut. Let's start with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can come here this morning. We thank you that you are a good God who is worthy to be praised, and help us to praise you this morning with whatever we're coming with this morning, Lord. However our week has been, however our morning has been, let our focus and our attention be on you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Sue, would you like to come and do the notices?
Very, very few notices. So this week on Thursday, 7:45 at Solent, is the church's prayer meeting. Do come along to that. There is no growing together tomorrow. What else is on this week? Let me think. Life groups, do check with your life group leaders whether it's on or not. And I think that is just about it, unless I've forgotten anything.
Thank you, Sue. Just say the good winds, give me a wave, are here this morning, so please do feel free to catch up with them. Not right now, after the service, it would be great. Let's stand and sing our first song, Come People of the Risen King. Let's stand and sing.
Yeah.
stay standing and we'll go into our next song, How Great Thou Art. Just to throw you. Am I okay to speak? Is it? Yeah, good. So I just wanted to share a little bit, a bit of a reflection. I must confess, this week has been taken up, or a lot of my mind has been taken up with being in a performance. So I was in a play this week, and so I wanted to reflect a little bit on learning lines and how we can think of that and learn from that and reflect on that with the Christian life. So when we got our script, here's mine, it's really battered, and I highlighted my bits. I had to memorize it, and it was, okay, so I'm going to memorize it, I'm going to go over it, I'm going to repeat it until it's in my head. But when learning lines, that's not enough. It's not enough just to learn the words and then just blurt them back out. You learn the words, you learn what they mean. You have to understand what it is you're saying. And then once you've understood what you're saying, you reflect on it, you mull it over so that you know how to then say it. And it was something that in conversation with people that I was having as in my acting group, that you learn your lines until they become the natural response to someone else's line. And I thought, that's how we should be thinking about Scripture. That we should come to Scripture and we should spend some time memorizing it. We should learn some verses. We should learn whole passages and have them in our head. Psalm 1 says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He has it in his head to think about. But it's not just, well, I've memorized it, and so I could blurt out these random verses and tell you, oh, I know, yeah, Revelation 4:11, and just blurt it out. I'm not going to. I'll do it later. But it's not just memorizing it and blurting it out. When you learn Scripture, reflect on it. Understand what it means. Take that time to really let it sink in and be part of you. And then more than that, what that then becomes is as you meditate on God's word, on God's law, on the life of Jesus displayed in the Gospels, in the message of salvation written about in the epistles, that should then become that natural response in your conversations and the way you handle things. It's not just, oh, I've memorized Scripture and I go about and do whatever I want. It should become part of you. And as I've spent a lot of time thinking about memorizing stuff, that really hit me this week, that I need to spend more time memorizing Scripture and letting it dwell in my head and in my heart and reflecting on it. And so I wanted to encourage all of us. The younger ones have a bit of an advantage, maybe with your memory could be a bit better. You've got more time to learn more Scripture. But we should all be spending time in God's Word, not just reading it, not just memorizing it for the sake of it, but to let it dwell in us and change how we think and speak. I'm going to ask Lizzie to come up and lead us in prayer, and then we're going to sing a song about a Bible verse, and that will help us to remember something. Thank you, Lizzie.
Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we come before you immensely grateful for the gifts that you give us. We trust and acknowledge in your great power that created, sustains, and guides this world, and for your great unfathomable love for us, your children. The psalmist David writes, some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we trust in the name of our Lord. We know that worldly powers and material possessions can be alluring, and many rely on them for their identity and purpose. But we know that these things are fleeting and uncertain, and that we were made to live in relationship with you. Nothing else in this world can satisfy. We declare again this morning that our trust is in you alone. You are our rock
and our fortress, an ever-present help in times of trouble. Help us to remember this, Lord, as we go about our lives, not just here on Sunday. In times of doubt, in times of uncertainty and fear, when we're tempted to rely on our own understanding and resources, remind us to trust in you. Teach us to develop a habit of regularly seeking your guidance each day in prayer, from the minute we wake to the minute we rest for sleep. Lord, empower us as a community of believers to support one another in faith. When we face trials, may we find strength and encouragement in your promises and in the fellowship we share. Liberate us from being distracted by our own desires, to choose to do your will as a church. Grant us wisdom to discern how you can use us and courage to follow you wherever you lead. Strengthen our faith so that, like David, we can declare with confidence that our hope and trust are in you alone. We pray for those around us who may be struggling and feeling overwhelmed by life's battles. May they find peace in your presence and strength in our community. Let us be instruments of your love and grace. Thank you, Father, for being our source of strength and our refuge. With every step we take, may we glorify your name and reflect your love to the world around us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
So we're going to stand and sing, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." That's what Jesus said, and that's a great way to memorize some scripture, is to learn it through songs. Let's stand and sing. Take a moment, say hello to someone next to you, behind you, in front of you. Jean to come up and read from the Bible for us.
The reading this morning is from John chapter 11, verses 17 to the end, on the end of that passage, 17 to 44. Your page in the Bible would be 1078 if you're using a church Bible. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into this world. After she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you'd been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, see how he loved him. But some of them said, could not he, who opened the eyes of the blind, who kept this man from dying? Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there's a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go.
Thank you, Jean. We're going to stand and sing a song, Abide With Me, and then Mike is going to come and open God's word to us.
Thank you. Morning, everyone. John chapter 11. Sunday mornings, we've been looking at conversations that Jesus had with people in John's Gospel. And as we do that, we get to understand more about Jesus, but also see how Jesus potentially impacts on our own lives. And this particular conversation is one I think we will all relate to. Because in this conversation, Jesus comes into a family in a crisis of suffering, in a situation of grief. And I know some of us are actually in such a situation this morning, dealing with grief in our family. Some of us will have done that in the past. We will all do it in the future. Jeremy Clarkson, that famous philosopher, is not enjoying getting older. And he said, really, we're all dead men walking. And that's true, isn't it? But we don't really like to think about it on a lovely summer's day at the seaside. But the Bible is far more comfortable talking about death than we are, because Jesus makes a critical difference. So, in this conversation, Jesus is coming to a family whom he is really close to. Mary, Martha, and their brother Lazarus. And Lazarus has fallen really seriously ill. So they send a message on foot to where Jesus is, a day or so away. And it's like a 999 call. Help! Our brother Lazarus is ill. What would you do if you had such a call on your phone? Okay, so you're not Jesus. But I think we would drop everything, wouldn't we? We would drop what we were doing. We would rush over there. We would do everything we could to help. But look what Jesus does. Verse 4, when Jesus hears about it, he says, this will be for God's glory. Verse 5, it makes a point about how much Jesus loved this family, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. And then verse 6, he stays where he is for two more days. Jesus delays. Jesus delays. That's one of the really, I think, difficult things about being a Christian sometimes. When you're suffering, you naturally throw out questions like, where is God in all this? What is God doing in the pain of your own illness and mental and emotional problems? And sometimes the crises that swirl around us, we can feel like God is absent, and we naturally ask those questions. And the really weird thing, I think, about being a Christian, or it can feel weird, is we know God could stop it if he wanted to. But he doesn't. And as Jesus comes into this situation, three times people say, if you had been here, if you'd been here, surely you could have stopped it. Surely you could have made a difference. But he wasn't. The thing is, when we're suffering, when we're in pain, what we want is the pain to stop, don't we? We just want relief. But as a parent, you know that your children always tend to want things now, aren't you? They're not necessarily good at deferred gratification. but you know it's not always good to give them what they want now. And you know, as a parent, that it's not always good to rescue them from every challenge. If you helicopter parent and rescue them from every challenge, then they never develop that ability or resilience themselves. Now, God is perfectly wise. We are fallible parents. We don't know everything. God is perfectly wise. And we only see a narrow view of life. But God sees the whole picture and all the different moving parts. And God is coordinating everything there for the good of those he loves. And so the 99 call goes out to Jesus, help! And he doesn't move. And the reason he doesn't move is he wants this family to see something more of the glory of God. He wants them to know that there is something better for this family that he has. It's actually something more important than them avoiding grief. And that is that they might grow in faith in the Son of God. Because it's better for us, it's better for them, not to hold on too tightly to what they cannot keep, but it's better for them to learn how to gain what they cannot lose. Not to hold on too tightly to Lazarus, who one day they're going to have to let go of anyway. But to gain what they cannot lose, eternal life. And that's what he wants them to see. So Jesus delays. Now around that time there was a folk belief that when somebody died, the soul hovered over the body. And the soul hovered over the body for 3 days before finally departing. When does Jesus turn up? 4 days after Lazarus has been in the tomb. So it's absolutely unambiguous that the guy is dead. And to the suffering family, that feels like too late. But for what Jesus is about to do, we'll see that his timing is absolutely spot on. Jesus delays. And as he comes, when he arrives at Bethany, Martha runs out to meet him. Now, you know people like Martha. Martha is the organizer. Martha is the one with a really tidy, organized mind. And even now, in this crisis, Martha's mind is working overtime. She is trying to process what's going on, what do we need to do, what does it mean? And so to Martha, Jesus brings truth. Verse 21. She says, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now, God will give you whatever you ask. So she has faith in Jesus. She wished he'd been here to stop it. But even now, she knows that Jesus will make some kind of difference. She doesn't know what. And what Jesus is going to do is he's going to develop that faith. In the conversation with Martha, Jesus asks her whether she believes people will rise again. And as a good Jew, you believed that everybody would be raised at the end. There would be a judgment to life or to death, a general resurrection of everybody. That's what she believes. And then Jesus says to her, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the one who raises people at the end. I am the eternal life. There is no life beyond the grave apart from me. That's an astonishing claim, isn't it? Previously, Jesus, in these conversations, has told the woman at the well that he is the water of life. He's the one who meets the deepest needs of our soul. He is the bread of life. He's the one who feeds us, who gives our soul what we need. And now he goes on to explain that that life that he gives is beyond death. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. They will die and then they will live. I am the resurrection and the life. When Jesus says, I am, what, I suppose one of the implications of that is the moment you find him, you find that life. You don't have to wait until you die to find eternal life. You find it when you find Jesus, because he is the resurrection and the life. So to Martha, because of the way her mind works, Jesus brings truth. And we need truth, don't we? We need truth to process big things like this. It's no good having a vague hope at that point, or some folk belief that you're with the angels, or that's you, the star shining in the sky. No, we need a stronger truth than that, and that is what Jesus brings to Martha. Martha believes in him, but he's developing her belief. Martha, this is the bigger truth you haven't yet got yet, and she will, as she sees it demonstrated, come to understand it. But then there's Martha's sister Mary, and Mary is a completely different sort of personality. Mary is one of those people that's hard to work with in youth group and stuff, because you never know what she's going to come up with. Mary is more emotional. Mary is more intuitive. Mary waits for the moment. She's sensitive. She waits until Jesus calls her before she comes, and then she springs up the moment he calls her and rushes out to meet Jesus. I don't know if you've ever experienced a funeral in another part of the world. In a part of the world where they really go for it. You know, we're very restrained in our grief, aren't we? But there's places where they really let it out at the funeral. And at the funeral, there would have been all kinds of mourners, maybe even people paid to do the job, to help the family mourn, to get out their feelings. And as the mourners see Mary get up, they follow her because they think she's going to weep at the tomb. So as Mary comes towards Jesus, there is this cacophony of wailing all around. And he sees Mary, and she's broken and crying, and Jesus weeps. To Mary, Jesus brings tears. Do you see how he gets people? Martha needs one thing, Mary needs something else. Jesus brings tears. But it's not the only emotion that Jesus brings into this situation. There's a phrase that's used twice. It says Jesus was deeply moved in spirit. First says it in verse 33, and then again verse 38. Jesus was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. It's really hard to translate. But apparently it's used of like when a horse is really angry. You know what a horse does when it's really angry? Goes up on its rears up on its hind legs, and the nostrils flare, and it snorts, and it makes a that was a horsey noise. It's that kind of thing. The horse is, that's how the horse expresses anger. Jesus was deeply moved like that. He was indignant. He was enraged, and you could see it in him. Because God's world wasn't supposed to be like this. God hadn't made it for people to be suffering like that and oppressed by death. And here is Jesus, able to make a difference, and the people around him don't see it and believe in him. And he's outraged in his soul at everything that's wrong and the intrusion of death into God's good world. Jesus is full of emotion. But for Mary, Jesus has tears. Verse 35, Jesus wept. Shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. In some religion, God is great, God is to be honored, but God is distant. He's personally removed. He doesn't come close. But Jesus shows us otherwise, doesn't he? God comes close to those in grief. God walks alongside people in suffering. He empathizes with you. He weeps. He's been there. And his heart goes out to you. Jesus feels it. There's this famous incident in the concentration camp in Auschwitz. Trying to say this right, so for everyone in the room. Someone is assassinated in front of the crowd. As the crowd disperses, conversation is, so where was God when that happened? And as afterwards, years afterwards, the guy writes about his experience in Auschwitz. He said, God was killed there in Auschwitz. Not literally, obviously, but God was there. God was feeling the outrage more than anybody else felt the outrage, because he knows how things are supposed to be. So in this situation, Jesus brings tears. When you or I go through suffering, it's so important to know that, isn't it? Nobody else knows exactly what you feel. Nobody else knows exactly in your situation exactly how you're affected. But God does. God truly gets you, and God truly knows and empathizes. And the one who is there cares and completely understands. And that's what Mary experiences as Jesus weeps with her. I think that's incredibly important. But even so, we need more, don't we? I mean, it's great that God cares. But Ukraine, the Middle East, just feeling sorry about stuff and really empathizing with people, that doesn't change anything, does it? So Jesus, in his anger about all that's wrong, fuming, walks to the tomb like a champion who is going to defeat what we cannot defeat. I heard this interview with the famous Richard Dawkins, really famous atheist. And as one of his colleagues, she was the up and coming, she was the next big atheist. She was called Ayaan Hirsi Ali. Anyway, he'd heard that Ayaan Hirsi Ali had found faith. He didn't really believe it. He thought she just adopted a Christian morality. So they're on this platform talking about it. And then, to his amazement, she really has found faith. And Dawkins is sort of banging his head, saying, because he really respects her intellectually, and says, I am, but you do understand that to be a Christian, you have to believe certain things, right? It's not just a feeling and a connection. You have to believe certain things. And every Sunday, you go to church, and the vicar stands at the front, and talks a complete load of nonsense about virgin births and walking on water and things we know not to be true. And this is one of them, surely. Isn't it? Jesus says to Lazarus, Jesus says, stands at the tomb and says, "Lazarus, come out." And wait for it. It says the dead man came out. That's a ridiculous verse, isn't it? The dead man came out. That just doesn't happen. It's a definition of being dead. Dead men don't come out. Well, they don't. Not unless the Son of God speaks life to them. The person who is behind everything that is, who in the beginning said, "Let there be light," and there was light, comes to the earth. And he says to the dead, "Come out." And Lazarus staggers out, looking like an Egyptian mummy with cloth all wrapped around his hands and his legs and wrapped around his head. And Mary and Martha and Lazarus see that he is the resurrection and the life. Jesus brings life. I think there's a contrast here. If we read further on in the Gospels, it reminds us of something. Lazarus comes out and he's all bandaged head to toe, like the sort of mummy in Scooby-Doo. But one day, Lazarus will die. This isn't permanent. Jesus has raised him, but he is going to die later. When Jesus rose, do you remember? He rose out of the bandages. So he was wrapped in grave clothes. But when they came to the grave, it says, John chapter 20, they found the grave clothes neatly folded up. Because Jesus wasn't raised like Lazarus. Jesus was raised with a different kind of body. He was raised out of the bandages with a new spiritual body to a new life that is forever. Where we never die again. And so the raising of Lazarus points to, I think, to the ultimate sign of Jesus' resurrection, and there death is defeated forever. That's why he can say, "The one who believes in me will live even though they die." One day, the Son of God will say to, say my granddad, will say, "Harry Carpenter, come out of the grave." And he won't come out shuffling in his slippers like he always did in the old people's home. But he will come out of the grave and he will rise to everlasting life. Because Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And old Harry believed in Jesus. And he will rise to the new life that Jesus brings, where there is no more suffering and no more tears. Where he sits on the throne and makes everything new. And everything that's wrong and broken and messed up becomes undone and untrue forever. So Jesus brings life. Sometimes I think there's a tendency to sort of go to God in a crisis. People seek God in a crisis, and God can really meet people there. But we need more than answers to each specific crisis and situation. What we really need is Jesus Christ, because he is the one who's reversing everything that's wrong, do you see? So Jesus brings life to this situation of terrible grief. But then there's a twist, because there's something else needed in order to put things right. If it was a really long chapter, this, that's why we didn't read the whole thing. But if we'd read the opening verses, in the opening verses, when Jesus gets the message that Lazarus is perhaps fatally ill, there's a debate with the disciples. And the disciples say, you don't want to go to Bethany, because last time you went to Bethany, they tried to stone you. That makes no sense to go there. Jesus kind of says, well, we're going. And as it happens, what the disciples say turns out to be right, because as a result of Jesus going and raising Lazarus, says quite a few believe, but the people who are against Jesus, the religious authorities, say this is getting well out of hand, and it says from this moment onwards, they started to plot to kill him. So do you see that by choosing to go and raise Lazarus, Jesus triggers the process that starts his own death? Because that's how he's going to put things right. God doesn't put things right by power from a distance. He puts things right by coming and sorting it out. And every day, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, drew back the curtains and he looked out on the same world that you and I look out on. A world that's good, but a world that is blighted by suffering and sin and selfishness and death. And as he dies, he takes all that rubbish on himself. He's pierced for our transgressions and crushed for our iniquities. And he carries our sufferings, carries our sorrows and bears our sufferings. He defeats it by bearing it and taking it on himself and then being raised to a new life where none of that stuff applies anymore. So that's an amazing chapter, don't you think? And it's so relevant to us because we all face suffering and none of us can dodge death. No matter how many kale smoothies you drink or how many exercise classes you go to, it's coming. For some of that, maybe feels closer. But you reach an age, don't you, as you look back on your life and you realize kind of how much life in the world has changed since you were a nipper. And although a lot does change, and much for the better, governments come and go, the fundamentals of being a human being on this planet have not changed. Sin and death, things that we haven't sorted and we cannot sort. And so each of us faces this choice. Are we going to face those on our own? Or are we going to face those in Christ who's overcome them? John says about all the things he's written in his gospel. He says, I've selected these particular things. I've written them down so that you might believe, and believing have life in his name. That's why I've written this, so that you will believe and have the life that he's talking about. And that's what Jesus says to Martha. Do you believe? To believe means to trust yourself to something, to someone. And surely you can trust yourself to someone like Jesus, who delays but with such wisdom, who brings the truth that we need, who brings tears, who takes all that's wrong on himself and defeats in the end the enemy of death. surely you can trust yourself to someone like that. In these conversations throughout the gospel, Jesus is showing himself to us. He's kind of offering himself to us. And if we receive him, it will transform our own experience of suffering. Watch this.
Occupied. You're hiding, biding your time. For what? A deeper challenge? A grander entrance? A brighter glory? A better story? The nick of time is a good story. That would do. 11th hour, you'd come through. Midnight, you were due. Now it's 2:30. Where were you? You've been here, my brother, would not have died. You were meant to ride in on the white horse, enter the fray, the dragon slay, save the day. Did you hear us pray? Did you want it this way? If you've been here, stop him dying. Why are you crying? You're meant to be death-defying. Why are you sighing at the tomb, decrying mortal ruin? In God's name are you queuing for the same? You're commander-in-chief. We demanded relief. Now you landed beneath all our sorrows and grief. Now it's you on your knees, empty-handed, bequeathing us none of our pleas. Is this what you chose? To bring only tears? We got plenty of those. Why are you here? You say to go near. And then to sink like a stone past the brink.
Thank you, Mike. And I think that sermon, that video has left us with a lot to think about and a lot to reflect on. Let's end by standing to sing, "Where, O Grave, is Your Victory?"
Just sometimes this is a new song to people, so I was just thinking we might do two verses and a chorus, sitting down for a moment, and then when, and then we'll go back to the beginning, and then we'll sing it from the beginning. It's called "Where O Grave Is Thy Victory." I think it's written to what Mike has just said. Okay, we're going to do two verses and a chorus.
Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are King over everything. You are King over the grave. You are King over this world. Lord, help us to really trust in you, not just look for you in crisis, not just think, oh, things are going well and so I can praise you, but to really trust in you and take to heart that passage that we've heard spoken to us this morning. That you are King, and your timing is what matters. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please do be seated. There will be refreshments served through the doors here.